Good evening. We'd like to call the Durham City Council meeting to order. I certainly want to welcome all of you that are here with us this evening. If we could just take a moment for a silent meditation, please. Thank you. I would ask Councilman Brown if he would lead us in the pledge. If you would call a roll, please.
Mayor Bell.
Present.
Mayor Pro Tem Cole McFadden. Councilmember Brown.
Here.
Councilmember Cotati. Councilmember Davis.
Here.
Councilmember Moffitt.
Here.
And Councilmember Shultz.
Here.
We have two proclamations that we'd like to present this evening, and there will be another resolution that will be coming up a little bit later in our agenda. I would ask Don Greeley, right behind me, Director of Water Management. This is the 40th anniversary of the Safe Drinking Water Act proclamation. And it reads, whereas water is a basic and essential need of mankind, whereas the health, comfort, and standard of living of our citizens depends upon the availability and reliability of safe drinking water, whereas throughout the years, the City of Durham has built upon the foundation established by the Federal Safe Drink Water Act of 1974, has taken a lead role in source water management and protection, as well as the production of a consistent high supply of quality drinking water, whereas the clean waters of our reservoirs provide habitat that supports plant and animal life and offer recreational opportunities such as bird watching, fishing, and boating, are providing the natural scenic beauty that is appreciated by visitors and residents of all ages, whereas changing climate and global warming may impact the availability of our precious natural resources, whereas our drinking water and water resources are undervalued, whereas dedicated individuals and organizations such as city employees, industry leaders, scientists, environmentalists, and students have made significant contributions in developing, operating, and maintaining these systems, protecting and conserving this precious resource, and education the public on the value of this resource. Now, therefore, I, William V. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby recognize December the 17th as the 40th anniversary of the Safe Drinking Water Act, and urge all citizens to join me in a toast to tap and to pledge to help keep our water sources safe for the next 40 years to extend the life of our most precious natural resource. With this in my hand, the corporate seal of the City of Durham, North Carolina, this is the 15th day of December. I'm going to present this to Don for any comments that he may have. Don?
Thank you, Mayor Bell. I'm honored to accept this proclamation on behalf of the Water Supply Treatment Division and the employees of the Department of Water Management. Our staff of more than 300 is dedicated to making sure that Durham's tap water meets or surpasses all the requirements of the Safe Drinking Water Act. The city has always been committed to doing whatever it takes to ensure that whenever Durham citizens turn on the tap, clean, safe, and high-quality water flows out. In addition to the teamwork among the staff of our various divisions, this also requires careful long-range planning for new facilities and sources, as well as the commitment from the City Council, the City Administration, and our citizens to support increasing rates in the robust capital improvement program. Although the Safe Drinking Water Act is celebrating its 40th anniversary, Durham has always been fortunate to have been at the forefront of water quality since the early 1900s. We pledge to continue our efforts to make a reliable supply of safe drinking water available to our customers beyond the next 40-year milestone. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. Next, I'd like to ask Ms. Joan Walsh and others if you'd like to bring with you. This is a proclamation recognizing Human Rights and Bill of Rights Day. Ms. Walsh is a member of the Bill of Rights Defense Committee. The proclamation reads, whereas the City of Durham is home to a diverse population, including students, working people, and retirees, citizens and non-citizens, all of whom add to Durham's cultural resources, richness, and economic vitality, whereas the City of Durham is committed to the human and civil rights of all its residents, and to actions that both protect and preserve those rights, whereas the City of Durham respects and recognizes the civil rights and liberties guaranteed all by the Bill of Rights, whereas on October 20, 2003, the City of Durham adopted both the Bill of Rights, Defense Resolution, and Resolution Number 9046, supporting the rights of persons irregardless of immigration status, and whereas the City of Durham recognizes the importance of maintaining a climate of acceptance and solidarity, thereby decreasing fear and promoting the cooperation of all residents with law enforcement, whereas each year, December 10th through 16th, is designated as Human Rights Week, and today, December 15th, is designated as Bill of Rights Day. Now, therefore, I, William B. Bill Bell, Mayor of the City of Durham, North Carolina, do hereby proclaim December 15, 2014, as Human Rights and Bill of Rights Day in Durham, and hereby urge all citizens to join me and all members of the Durham City Council in reaffirming our support of the Bill of Rights and of the civil rights and liberties it guarantees to all. We urge all residents to support the city's efforts to welcome immigrants, in particular the many Central American children and adolescents who have come here without adults, fleeing violence in their home countries, and have been welcomed by our schools and assisted by other agencies. We also urge support for the city's recent decision to require that police obtain written consent for any vehicle searches other than those for which there is a warrant of probable cause. With my hand, Corporate Seal of the City of Durham, North Carolina, this is the 15th day of December, 2014. And I should have asked Councilman Steve Shule, if you join me here, for any comments. But Steve was pretty instrumental in helping to author this proclamation.
Okay, good. Ms. Walsh. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and city councilors for this proclamation. It's a wonderful occasion, much appreciated each year, and this year in particular with the change that has been made to the regulation regarding written consent for vehicular searches. Just recently, we've experienced a flood of awareness of human rights issues that affect us locally. 6 days ago, as you know, the Senate Intelligence Committee released a redacted summary of its extensive report on rendition and torture. We now have in the public domain an official recognition of the shocking human rights violations many of us knew were committed by our government during the previous decade. 17 of the survivors listed in the report's redacted summary were rendered to torture by Aero contractors based next door in Johnston County. And data show that at least another 17 were as well. This is a long-awaited moment for accountability, restitution to those whose lives have been destroyed, and a pledge that such abuses will never happen again. North Carolina has a special responsibility to investigate Aero and to apologize and make restitution to its survivors. Public attention also is focused on the recent failure of justice in the police killings of unarmed African-American men and a 12-year-old African-American boy who was playing with a toy gun. This lack of accountability has given rise to a youth movement such as hasn't been seen in several decades. I hope this movement and the Moral Monday Forward Together movement will join forces here to renew our state as a progressive beacon in the South and as part of a national movement for human and civil rights. Thank you again for all you have done this year in Durham for constitutional and human rights and all that you will do in 2015.
You probably recognize the fact that a few of us don't have jackets on this evening. I had to take my car to have it serviced this morning, and they carried me back to my office. I usually leave my jacket hanging in my coat in the back of my car, but I put it in my office. And when I left and came to City Hall tonight, looked in the back seat, didn't have my coat, so that's why I'm without a coat. But a couple of my colleagues, they couldn't find coats for me, so they decided to take theirs off. So that's why I was dressed. You didn't know that, Gene?
No, I did not.
All right. You can leave yours on there. You didn't know about it.
Okay.
No, you're fine. You're fine. You're fine. You're fine. Let me ask the other priority items by the city manager.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. No priority items.
Likewise, recognize the city attorney.
No priority items, Mr. Mayor.
Likewise, the city clerk.
No items, Mr. Mayor.
Well, we have a rather special resolution that we'd like to present this evening. And it's a resolution that's in the hands of the city attorney, but it recognizes one of Durham's citizens who grew up here and has been nominated by the President of the United States to be the next United States Attorney General. Probably most of you know Loretta Lynch. While she wasn't born in Durham, she grew up in Durham, considered this to be home. Her parents live here, Reverend and Mrs. Lynch. And we have prepared to present a resolution, and I'd like the city attorney, if he would present that, and I would like to ask Reverend Lynch, who's in the audience, if you would come up with us, please, if you don't mind coming up. It isn't often where we have such recognition to be bestowed upon citizens of Durham. All of our citizens are great, but in a case such as this is really unique. It's an honor, and by honoring Ms. Lynch, you also honor the city of Durham, but more importantly, you honor her parents, who, but not without them, she wouldn't be receiving this. So, Reverend Lynch, I don't know if you have any comments that you want to make before or afterwards.
Say thanks to the city council for this kind of support and this kind of encouragement. The the United States Senate's Committee on the Judiciary perhaps will take this up next year. And she has been meeting with individual senators even last week or so, and even this week. But we all joke sometime, I said, that she's headed for a tough place. I won't use the language that I use, but she's headed for a tough place. And we hope she's going to hold out and do well during these hearings. Thank you all very much.
Mr. Mayor, Mr. Lynch, members of council, this is the resolution that's been prepared and will be before you for passage. Had I known the mayor was going to make me read it, I might have made it a little shorter. But as I was putting this information together, and I appreciate Mr. Lynch providing me with a scrapbook, if you will, of Ms. Lynch's career, it's an amazing career, and I'm honored to have actually prepared this and hope one day to get an opportunity to meet her. Resolution in support of Loretta Lynch nomination for U.S. Attorney General. Whereas Loretta Lynch was raised in Durham, North Carolina by her parents, Lorenzo A. Lynch, an ordained Baptist minister, and Lorene Lynch, a retired librarian. And whereas Loretta Lynch received her primary education in the Durham public school system from W.G. Pearson Elementary School, Whitted Junior High School, and graduated co-valedictorian of Durham High School. And whereas Loretta Lynch went on to graduate from Harvard University and with honors from Harvard Law School. And whereas in 1990, after spending 6 years as a litigation associate with a private law firm in New York, Loretta Lynch answered the call to public service when she joined the Office of the United States Attorney for the Eastern District of New York as an Assistant United States Attorney. And whereas, based on her outstanding record of accomplishment, leadership, and work ethic, Loretta Lynch quickly rose through the ranks of the office and was promoted to Chief Assistant United States Attorney in 1998. And whereas in 1999, Loretta Lynch was nominated by President William J. Clinton and confirmed by the United States Senate to serve as the appointed United States Attorney for the Eastern District of North Carolina, where she served with this distinction until 2001. And whereas, in 2010, after serving as a partner in a private law firm in New York for 9 years, Loretta Lynch was nominated by President Barack H. Obama and confirmed by the United States Senate to serve a second term in the United States Attorney as the United States Attorney for the Eastern District of New York. And whereas, shortly after her confirmation, Loretta Lynch was appointed by the United States Attorney General Eric H. Holder, Jr., to serve on the Attorney General's Advisory Committee comprised of select United States attorneys from around the country. And whereas, in 2013, Loretta Lynch was appointed to serve as chair of the Attorney General's Advisory Committee. And whereas, on November 8, 2014, President Barack H. Obama formally announced his decision to nominate Loretta Lynch to succeed Eric H. Holder, Jr. as the 83rd United States Attorney General. And whereas, based on her outstanding legal credentials, long and distinguished record of public service, dedication to the equal enforcement of the law, the protection of civil rights, and her strong reputation as a fair and impartial federal prosecutor with exceptional integrity, Loretta Lynch is uniquely qualified to serve her country as the next Attorney General of the United States. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the City Council of the City of Durham, Section 1, that the City Council of the City of Durham endorses and supports the nomination of Loretta Lynch as Attorney General of the United States, Section 2, the City Council of the City of Durham recommends confirmation of her nomination by the United States Senate, Section 3, this resolution shall be effective on and after its passage.
Thank you, and the City Council will adopt this resolution, and the intent is obviously to give it to the parents, but just as importantly, to have it sent to the United States Senate Judiciary Committee. And I would suggest that we may also want to send it to our two U.S. senators. I know typically the nominee is introduced to the Senate by their hometown senator, but I know she's in New York, so Senator Schumer may be doing this, but I think it would be good to have our U.S. senators also receive this resolution. So, Reverend Lynch, after we will adopt this, we'll take those steps and certainly make a copy of this available to you and your family. And thanks again.
Thank you, sir.
So, I'd entertain a motion on the resolution.
Mr. Mayor, I move. I was going to say more than just move it, but that's okay.
All right, so it's been properly moved by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Councilman C. Shule, Councilman Shule. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We recognize. I'm going to recognize council person. Do you have a comment?
Good evening. I attended a press conference today that was called by Representative Moore, member of the State General Assembly. He plans to introduce a bill entitled Prohibit Discriminatory Profiling. I will send each of you a copy of it. The attendance was really good. There were legislators there, but I noticed that no one was there from our delegation. Maybe that's because they are in recess. But I'll send you a copy, and there were some thought-provoking things in this, and I'll send it to you.
Okay, are there other comments by members of the council? If not, I'm going to take a moment to speak to an issue. I'm not going to speak long, just want to. It has to do with the protests that have been occurring in our city. And I want to commend Councilman Don Moffitt for an email that I just read this evening before I came here. Don has been one of those persons that has been present, and he can speak for himself. But he's been very observant. And as I said, there are always two sides to a story, and then there's the truth. And of course, we've been getting different versions of what has happened at these protests, but I have no reason to believe that what Councilman Moffitt has presented in terms of his observation is not an accurate account of what has occurred. And I'm going to ask that somehow we make this more public. And Don, if you want to add anything to what I've just said, I would appreciate it.
Well, thank you. I haven't really thought about how to distill down my what I wrote into a few words, but I will say that I was present on Saturday evening, in that I was present last December. In my observations have been is that there are different groups involved in the protests with different agendas. And I think all of us understand the anger and frustration that arose once again with the decision in the Michael Brown case and the disgust, I think, that we all felt with the decision in the Eric Garner case. And I'm certainly disgusted with the Congress, with their even basically as we speak passing a funding bill that's going to allow the banks more latitude to engage in investing, speculating in the kinds of securities that caused the Great Recession and destroyed so much black wealth in this country. So we all understand the anger and the frustration. But and I think that there are people coming out and participating in the protests who are motivated by that. But I also believe there are people coming out and using those protests and the protests last fall for a different agenda, to provoke confrontation with the police in the hopes that they can get the police to overreact or to make a mistake. And I observed a lot on Saturday evening. I followed the march. I was present when the arrests were made. And I will say that your observation that there's, you know, two sides to every story and then the truth, there's, I mean, even I think people present there would have different versions of what transpired. But I do want to commend the police department. I feel like that they have been doing, that they've been demonstrating a tremendous amount of training and discipline and professionalism. And I know that there are people who are on, there are people that are unhappy with the situation from both sides, people who feel like there's been far too much leniency and people who feel like there's been far too much response. On Saturday night, I followed the protesters as they went from Walltown Recreation Center on Cullen Boulevard, down Buchanan, Markham, over to 9th Street, and onto Main Street. And in that entire time, I saw not one marked police car nor one uniformed police officer. So certainly no one can make the claim that the police were exacerbating a situation. As you all may know, the group that was leading the way typically wears masks and beats drums and blows whistles, in part to keep people from hearing instructions that are given to them by the police. They chose to turn south on Swift Avenue, which confused me. Earlier in the evening, I had heard people ask where 9th Street was and suggest perhaps going to Weaver Street Market. So I knew they weren't entirely familiar. Not everybody was familiar with Durham. And I thought that perhaps they were confused, and I realized that they were headed for the on-ramps to 147. And when I got up to the railroad tracks, I could see that the police had the same understanding, because for the first time I saw marked police cars, and there were a lot of them, and there were a lot of red and blue lights, and it was very clear that to proceed on Swift Avenue was to provoke confrontation. And that's what the protesters chose to do, and as a result, of course, there were 11 arrests. So that's, in brief, what I saw on Friday night, on Saturday night, excuse me. And certainly people that want to know a lot more are welcome to email me my city council address. We'd be glad to give you a long history of what I see as a protest over the last 13 months here in Durham. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. I had not discussed this with Don prior to this. As I said, I just happened to read his email in my office before I came down here this evening. Eddie had mentioned to me that Don had written something, but I hadn't seen it. But I think it's a side that needs to be told from this council's viewpoint. Ultimately, the city manager will be giving us a report on the internal investigation that the police department has made on its own activities. And I was reminded, and I don't know why, I just thought about it, that, and I asked the city attorney for this just this evening, this council had adopted rules and guidelines for protests after the Jose Herrera situation. I don't know if anybody has bothered to tell people this or not, but
It was very clearly the rules of conduct that this council adopted, not to stop protests, but to make sure that they're done in as orderly fashion as possible while still allowing persons who chose to participate to protest. So, Mr. Manager, I would just hope that we get this back again to the general public in particular, and if we know people who are organizing protests, to make sure they see these rules of conduct, if you don't mind.
Mr. Mayor?
I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
One brief thing I wanted to add. One of the things that we've heard about from different people is what's called the LRAD, the Long Range Acoustical Device. As I said, I was present in December. I saw the police use a bullhorn. I saw that it was ineffective. The police subsequently acquired the LRAD, which allows them to make announcements at a very high decibel level. I could clearly hear the announcements on Saturday night. There's been concern stated that it's a sonic weapon. What I have learned, I haven't learned the specifics, but I've learned that there are different types of LRADs and they have different strengths, and what the police department acquired could not be construed as a sonic deterrent device. And so I just wanted to let you all know that as I get more information, it's helping me to understand the situation.
Thank you. I recognize Councilman Brown.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And Don, thanks for your insight. I too was at the protest last Saturday, or whatever it was, a week ago. And I went as not just a member of the Durham City Council, but as an observer and also as a photographer. I thought and I was at the DPAC and then followed through to the CCB Plaza, and I thought the Durham Police Department acted professionally and at times with restraint. Now, I did not go down to Foster Street, as perhaps you did, Don. I guess I'd make a couple of points. One, and I'm really pleased, Mr. Mayor, that you brought that up concerning the resolution, instructional resolution, that we passed earlier this year concerning protest. And I think we need to remind ourselves and the police department and those who want to protest that we do have in this city certain restrictions that concern anyone and everyone who wants to protest. I think that's really, really crucial. And then secondly, some of us who marched in the 1960s for civil rights, and you don't hear this term that much anymore. It's called civil disobedience. Civil disobedience is where you break the law knowingly and lovingly, but you suffer the consequences. You go to jail, and that's what was used primarily in the 60s. But this group does not seem to adhere to that belief, which is sad. Changing times, I guess, but some things that change are not for the better. I guess I would also suggest to the protesters that, and I think I can speak for my colleagues sitting up here this evening, we were just appalled, certainly by the New York decision as well as Edison, Missouri, and very disgusted by it. But on the other hand, in terms of the protesters, when is enough enough? What are they trying to do now? And I think some of their tactics are definitely not the way to use an old term, win friends and influence people. Indeed, just the opposite may be happening. So, in conclusion, I want to thank Don and the mayor again for bringing this up. And I think it's really important that we get that resolution that we passed unanimously as a council out into the public once again, as well as to the police. Because when you start blocking major highways and streets as well, in my judgment, that's not a very smart thing to do. And I think you're alienating many more people than you're trying to convert or win to your side. And I must say, I was at my Sunday school class yesterday at First Presbyterian. We had a discussion on this, and quite frankly, I was somewhat disappointed in terms of how some of the participants were basically trying to blame the police for almost everything, and not looking definitely at the other side, not seeing some of the flyers that we have seen that have gone up. And there's definitely an element. All it takes is 2 or 3%, folks, of that crowd to instigate negative actions. And there's a herd mentality about some of this as well. And they're there just for that. I mean, they're basically, and they call themselves this, anarchist. It's not my description. It is theirs. And they're there just to inculcate into the crowd disobedience, but not civil disobedience. So I would hope that in the future we would take perhaps actions and responses that reflect the resolution that we as a council passed. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Okay, we'll proceed with the agenda. First item being consent agenda. Before I do that, I recognize we have some scouts in the audience, and someone might want to stand up and tell us who you are and who you represent, if you don't mind. Well, thank you. Well, welcome to the Durham City Council meeting. Thank you. The first item on our agenda are consent agenda items. If a member of the council chooses to pull an item, someone in the public chooses to pull an item, we'll pull that item. It'll be discussed later in the agenda. Otherwise, it can be passed with a single motion, seconded by a city council person. And again, I just read the heading of each one of the consent agenda items. Item one is approval of city council minutes. Item two is citizens advisory committee appointment. Item three is the mayor's appointee, Raleigh-Durham Airport Authority. Item four is the mayor's nominee for appointment, passenger vehicle for hire commission. Item five is correction to zoning map change ordinance for Hanover Point subdivision, sub-area C, Z14000004. Item six is option contract with Southside Revitalization Phase 2 LP for the second phase of development for the loss at South Point. Southside. Item seven is engineering and related design services for Southside Homeownership Phase 2. Item eight is the United States Department of Transportation SHRP-2 C-16 grant project ordinance for the evaluation of the impacts of smart growth on travel demand. Item nine is dam inspections, maintenance, and rehabilitation. Item 10 is amendment number one to the Eno Economic Development District Water and Sewer System Project. Professional Engineering Services, CDM Smith, Inc. Item 11 is a contract for utility bill printing and mail services. Item 12 is, I'm sorry,
Item 12 is Pulte Home Corporation land donation to the City of Durham of 3.66 acres located at 5503 Leesville Road and 0.384 acres. A portion of the parcel located at 5650 Leesville Road for Fire Station 17. Item 13 is additional funding construction contracting authority for City Hall Annex and Building Envelope Project. Item 14 is approval of the Durham Convention Center interlocal agreement between the City of Durham and County of Durham for joint ownership of the Durham Convention Center. Item 15 is the third amendment to the management agreement by and between City and County of Durham and Global Spectrum LLP for the Durham Convention Center. Item 16 is U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, EPA, 2014-2017, Brownsville Community-Wide Assessment Grant for Northeast Central Durham and other targeted areas, grant project ordinance and authorization to execute grant agreement. Item 17 is telecommunications license agreement with Earthlink Carrier, LLC. Item 18 is CIP ordinance amendment for Northern Way Subdivision failed development reimbursement. And items 19 through 21 are items that can be found on the general business agenda as public hearings. Entertain a motion for the approval of the consent agenda. It's been properly moved by Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Councilman Cotati. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
We move into the general business agenda public hearings. Item 19 is consolidated annexation, Ravenstone extension, case BDG 14000005.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Young with the planning department. I can first certify for the record that all public hearing items before you tonight have been advertised in accordance with the requirements of law, and there are affidavits to that effect on file with the planning department. The request before you, BDG 14005, Ravenstone Extension, is a request for utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation, and initial zoning by Lennar Carolinas LLC for property totaling approximately 117.1 acres. Located along Sharon Road, south of NC Highway 98. This would be, if approved, a contiguous annexation representing an extension of the existing city limits, bordered by two similar residential subdivisions to the east and the west. The applicant has indicated a desire to construct up to 230 single-family homes on this site if the request is approved. The staff recommendation is an initial zoning of rural residential Falls Jordan Lake Protected Area B, otherwise known as RR and FJB, which is consistent with City Council policy to apply the least intensive zoning district allowable within the development tier. So if approved, this would be the lowest intensity development tier allowed in this zoning designation allowed in the development tier. The subject site is currently located in the county jurisdiction and zoned rural residential, FJB, and RS20, residential suburban 20. The Planning Commission at their August 12, 2014 meeting recommended approval of the zoning designation by a vote of 12-0. And staff recommends approval of this item. Thank you. I'll be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. You've heard the staff report. This is a public hearing. I will open the public hearing and ask if there are questions by members of the council. We have three persons that have signed up to speak on this item. Let me ask before the council comments, is there anyone else that wants to speak as we try to set the time for the hearing? If not, I will first recognize council members for any comments. I recognize Councilman Shule.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I just have one question. This is in the memo from Martha Ziegler to John Allure, attachment 5. And I mentioned this to Mr. Greeley just a minute ago, or earlier before the meeting. So just this this memo on the second page says that, as evidenced by the table above, the Department of Water Management will realize additional revenue from outside city rates. It would be my understanding, and I'm not sure I have this right, which is why I'm asking, that these would actually be inside city rates, and this is just a mistake in the memo rather than a mistake in some calculation that we made.
Yes. Good evening, Mayor, Mayor Pro Tem, members of Council, Don Greeley, Department of Water Management. That's correct, Councilman Shule, that's a mistake in the memo. Once it's annexed in, it'll be inside city rates.
Okay, thank you very much.
Any other questions by council? If not, then I'll call on persons who have signed up to speak. Let's take 10 minutes each, if necessary, for these comments. First call the proponent, Robert Schunk.
good evening. I don't have a formal presentation for this evening, but I'm here available for any questions you might have. Thank you.
In that case, we'll call on the persons who have signed up to speak as opponents, Brian Scarelli and Gina Scarelli, is that correct? Okay. Sharkayla, that wasn't correct then, thank you. If you could just state your name and address for the record then.
I'm Gina Scarcella. I live at 501 Hidden Brook Drive, the road that leads into the new development. We were notified about 6 months ago that there were houses going to be put in that area, 230 some odd houses, by that the man that was just up here. He held a meeting in a little church and had very little information for us, but we don't have any information. They've not been contacting us. We live on the street less than a quarter, eighth mile away from where the new houses are going to be developed. I found this memo in by accident about it. My house is not on there, my address. I live on Hidden Brook. That is a main thoroughfare into that neighborhood. When I purchased the house, it was a dead-end driveway, and it was wonderful, and I was never notified of any moving of streets or trees, and I just came home one day and all the trees were cut down. I was also never notified of that by anything from the city or the county. And so this time, I know I'm probably not going to stop development, but I'd like to pause for a moment because I have no information on water runoff problems, because the Hidden Brook is hidden behind my house. So all of that water is gonna go through my property when all of the new roads are gonna come in. Which new roads and 230 more homes? I don't know if anybody has ever driven on Sharon Road to get to Highway 70. Those 3 miles take me now approximately 15 to 20 minutes. That's a long time to go through a two-lane highway just waiting and waiting and waiting. So if we add those homes, it's going to increase my drive time to work. And not just mine, it's not all about Gina. Well, it might be. But then the trash from when they opened the roads, our little road is completely trashed. We're picking up trash constantly. The speed limit is 25, but it's 65 through there. We don't have small children. One house does. There's 8 houses on that street. But we do have our doggies, and I have to cross the street to get my mail. That's now going to become Hidden Brook Drive, a major thoroughfare. There's only 2 or 3 exits to that neighborhood right now. So adding those 230 houses are going to make a big impact on many people's lives, not just mine. Then the schools, our property values, the crime rate. We've already installed alarm systems, as of many of our neighbors, because of the crime rate increase recently. And then we don't know how the utilities will be allocated either. Nothing has been communicated to my husband and I. We live in the middle of the street, not in the middle of the street, but in the middle of where all of this is going on. And we feel completely left out. Thank you.
Welcome. Brian Chappelle.
Thank you, City Council members. When we first moved into the area, it was a very rural area. And we feel that adding this many homes to the area will have a big impact on the characteristic of the area and the people who live there and grew up there and experienced it as a rural area. So we don't feel like we've been adequately informed. Additionally, we signed up with Lanier Homes, a representative of Lanier Homes, to be notified of any studies that were completed or as this progressed through, so we could raise our concerns with Lanier Homes. And we don't feel that they've followed through on that that request either. They requested, or they offered to sign us up as an email, and they did not send us the information or the studies. So we're kind of concerned about the impact to the residents as far as traffic, schools, utilities, drainage, and what that will do to the neighborhood. So we'd like to get a little bit more information about how that's going to be, what the impact is going to be. And we'd like the City Council to take into consideration Lanier Homes to take into consideration the impact on the residents who've lived there for a long time. And I think that's my conclusion. Thank you.
I didn't see, but were you present at the Planning Commission? So this is the first time that you've done something publicly, neither one?
Yes.
Let me ask, are there other persons that want to comment or speak on this item being a public hearing matter? If you would come forward and state your name and address, please.
Thank you for recognizing me. My name is Chastity Martin, and I live in the latest part of the Ravenstone Extension. I've been there since about 2011. And I can agree with what she's saying about the Hidden Brook. I don't live on that street, but I do have to pass her house every day to get out. Sometimes just on Hidden Brook itself, people are doing probably 65 or higher. There are a lot of wildlife there. And I just wondered, can we get information on the different things that have been done as far as the water? Have they done any environmental studies of what's gonna happen to the different wildlife, the trees, the, you know, everything that's around us, the streams, the brooks, the lake, everything that's there? We have heard nothing. We've just been told that it's gonna happen. So if we could get some information, that would be really great for all of us.
Let me ask, were you at the planning board hearing?
I didn't get that memo either.
Okay. Let me ask the staff, the persons that have spoken are, given the proximity to the project, were they entitled to receive the notices? If so, did they go out? If not, maybe you should say why they didn't receive them.
Sure. So, Mr. Mayor, I don't have the affidavit with me. I can get have staff go get the file from our office downstairs. But I'm based on the descriptions of locations, I'm confident they would have been provided notices, and I can confirm that.
Let me ask, are there other persons that want to speak on this item before we close the public hearing and bring it back to the council? If not, let the record reflect that no one else asks to speak. I'm not going to close the public hearing. I'm just going to bring it back to the council first. For any comments that council members may have, I recognize the city manager.
Mr. Mayor, could I ask Mr. Young just to briefly talk about the process going forward? You know, what this is. This is, you know, the annexation and the initial zoning, but a bit about what the site plan process will have to ensue, assuming that the council concurs with the staff recommendation.
Certainly, Mr. Manager, thank you. As the manager has alluded to, if this action is approved tonight, this applicant, the owner of the property, will have to submit what's called a site plan. A site plan contains a tremendous detail about the site development criteria, lot sizes, environmental protection areas, stormwater management devices, roadway access, and other site characteristics. There's not public notice provided for that, but there is an application that's provided to the Planning Department, and the Planning Department makes, through our website, makes the public aware of when those are submitted. So that information is available to the public. You can review the information. It's reviewed against an over 600-page rule book called a Unified Development Ordinance that will have to be met in order for any development to occur. So that's what would have to happen subsequent if this item were approved tonight.
Thank you. Yes, ma'am, you have a question.
Sir, why is it that we have to jump through so many hoops to get applications to get information that will so directly affect my life? Thank you.
Ma'am, I'm not sure what you're referring to in terms of hoops. We're happy to provide any information we have on what's been submitted to us.
I'm sorry, just your first time at the City Council, probably. Yeah, and I can appreciate that. We hear all the time. We don't get it right all the time either. Well, let me suggest that this is an annexation piece that we're talking about. The details, obviously, that you have concern about would come forth as the staff indicated. But it is an annexation piece, so that's the purpose of the hearing today. But I want to make sure that, Don, I want to make sure that you understand that at some point in time, given you are in the vicinity of what's required, you would be given a notice, and if you aren't, certainly you need to bring that attention to the city manager or members of the council. I recognize Councilman Moffitt.
Mr. Young, did I hear you say you had sent somebody down to get the files?
And I wasn't able to do that yet. I can do that. Here's what I can say. I can certify, as I did earlier, that anybody who was within the notification area, which is 600 feet from the property boundaries, was provided notice. That's in excess of what state law requires. It's what our local ordinance requires, and that was provided. Right. What I can't guarantee, based on the descriptions, is whether these folks are within those areas. We do have that information, but it's not on hand right now.
And that notification would go to the property owner. And that would be everybody who lives within 600 feet of the boundary of the area being developed. And then in addition, there would be signs posted out there?
That's correct.
And you probably don't know offhand where those signs were posted?
Not the precise locations, but on a site of this size, I know there was more than one sign posted.
Right.
Okay. Again, we can provide that information. Right. But the signs were posted, advertisement in the Herald Sun, and direct mail notifications.
So the reason I ask the questions and details, we hear a number of cases. It's the first time that I can remember someone coming and saying, we should have gotten notice and didn't get it. So it would be extremely unusual. And the second thing is I want to check with you on this. It's currently zoned, if I've read this correctly, RS20 and RR. And that the recommended zoning for this parcel is RR, is that correct?
So that's correct, Councilman Moffitt. This is an effect of downzoning. So it's a reduction in the density intensity that would be allowed on the site versus the current zoning.
So if we don't act tonight, the developers could actually develop it in a denser fashion with more homes than they could if we act tonight.
They would be allowed to do so under the current zoning.
Right, okay. So that's a thing to understand, is that the zoning that we're looking at applying, now this is an annexation, so they would come into the city, it's city property, and the people who live there would have to pay city taxes and receive city services. But the other effect would be that they could build fewer homes under tonight's action than they can currently, just as a point of awareness. So also, there is one of the things you should do before you leave. You should check in with these folks. There is a planner that's been working on this, and so you can get in touch with the planner. This department works with folks like you all the time, because there's always people who live next door, and they're really, really good at doing that. So check in, get the name of the planner, the phone number, and the contact, and you can get a lot more information.
Okay, thank you. Don, any other comments by members of the council? If not, the public hearing is closed and matters back before the council for consideration. Entertain a motion on the item. Item is an annexation item.
Second.
It's been properly moved by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Councilman Brown. Any further discussion? Hearing none, call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Now we have this consistency statement.
So moved.
It's been properly moved by the Mayor Pro Tem, seconded by Councilman Davis. Any further discussion? Hearing none, call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We'll move to item. Yes, recognize Councilman Shule.
I do want to just reiterate to the folks who are here today that what Councilmember Moffitt said earlier, if you all are interested in talking to our planning staff about this and getting more information, they will talk to you about it. And I appreciate that you feel like you need to jump through hoops and go to the website, but I do want to reiterate what he said. They are very open to talk to you about it, and so you should feel free to be in contact with them.
Mr. Mayor, if I might quickly, sure. Councilman Shule, we'll be happy to get the contact information for these folks and reach out to them tomorrow following this meeting.
Thank you. Okay, item 20, Consolidated Annexation, Massey's Chapel, case BDG 14-00009.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. The case before you, BDG 14-00009, Massey's Chapel, is a request for utility extension agreement, voluntary annexation and initial zoning for two parcels totaling approximately 3.11 acres, known as Massey's Chapel United Methodist Church, located off of Fayetteville Road. This is a contiguous annexation to current city limits, but it would create a connection to a satellite annexation located to the south of the subject site. The place of worship currently exists at this site. and no expansions of the present use are currently proposed. Staff recommends an initial zoning of rural residential with the FJB watershed overlay, which is equivalent, or excuse me, identical to the county zoning designation currently on the site. This represents the least intent zoning based on the development tier per city council policy. Staff recommends approval, and I'll be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Thank you. The staff has given his report. This is a public hearing. The public hearing is open. I'd ask first other questions by members of the council on the staff recommendation. Likewise, is anyone in the public that would like to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one in the public asked to speak on this item. I would declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded by Mayor Pro Tem Councilman Brown. Any further discussion? Hearing none, call the question. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
It's been properly moved and seconded by Mayor Pro Tem Councilman Brown. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? And close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Thank you. We move to item 21, street closing, Elder Street, street closing 14-0-0-0-0-11.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council. Pat Younging with the Planning Department. Case SC 14-0-0-0-11, Elder Street. Closing is an application by Ron Carpenter on behalf of Triangle Land Surveyors to close a 430.43 linear foot segment of Elder Street. This right-of-way is currently open. It's surrounded on both sides by property owned by Duke University. If the request is approved, the portion of the right-of-way would be recombined with adjacent properties owned by Duke University. The area adjacent to this right-of-way is zoned UC, University College, CG, Commercial General, and OI, Office Institutional, and it's located in the Duke Hospital compact neighborhood tier. Based on input received from partner agencies and service delivery agencies, no concerns were identified with this request, and staff recommends approval. Be happy to take any questions.
Thank you. You've heard the staff report. It's a public hearing item again. The public hearing is open. Ask the questions by members of the council. If not, is anyone in the public that wants to speak on this item, either for or against? Let the record reflect that no one asked to speak. I'll declare the public hearing to be closed. Matters back before the council.
Move the item, sir.
Second. It's been properly moved by Mayor Pro Tem, Councilman Brown. Madam Clerk, will you open the vote? Close the vote.
It passes 7-0.
Okay, any?
Let me give some clarity. Yeah. I'd just like to clarify the information I gave. The representative who is drafting the bill is Representative Rodney Moore, and Drew Morgan is his assistant.
Thank you. Any other items to come before the council? If not, the meeting's adjourned at 7:59 p.m. You guys can put your coats back on now.